Welcome back to the main stage. I hope you have enjoyed the sessions and made some new friends through the networking carousel or found some exciting projects at the business place.
Now, whilst people are joining us, I thought we could review the world of Twitter and see what people are saying about Excite 2021. I've got a few tweets here to share. Julian Bobroff, presently attending the great Excite conference. This afternoon at 3 p.m., we will speak about smartphones together with wonderful colleagues. And the session will start with a short live interactive game. How exciting. Mairead Hurley, really enjoying Excite 2021 in room 6 with a whole lot of participants. Strategies to support scientists learning in public engagement situations, purposeful listening, emotion, on-the-spot feedback, and trying risky new strategies. A big shout out to Victor. Victor was up at 5 a.m. Coming to us from Mexico. He was on his second coffee and he was ready for Excite. I loved the picture so much. I have immortalized him on my wall up here. So nice to meet you, Victor. Natalie Caplett, I tested the networking carousel at the Excite 2021 conference. 3-minute video meeting with a random willing conference participant. Love the idea. Thanks for the chat and great conference. And one more, it's Sweater, who also is a conference newbie. So, hey, Sweater, nice to have you here. She is also loving the networking carousel and she met some cool people like Anna Schaefer's and she is looking forward to the amazing lineup. So some great stuff coming out on Twitter and so good to hear people really enjoying that networking carousel.
Thank you, Brad. Now, before our first keynote speech, a message from the Kavli Prize partners who is sponsoring our very first keynote speaker, Ewine van Dishoeck, also herself the Kavli Prize award winner back in 2018.
What if we could understand the origin of the universe? What if we could improve lives by controlling atomic structures? What if we could truly grasp the complexities of the human brain? The story behind the Kavli Prize started in the 1930s with a curious boy named Fred, growing up among the tall mountains of Eresfjord in Norway. A deep curiosity about nature and the universe stayed with Fred throughout his studies in physics and his entrepreneurial success in the United States. Until he eventually established a philanthropic foundation with the vision of advancing science for the benefit of humanity. One of the first activities of this foundation led to the inauguration of the Kavli Prizes, beginning in 2008. The prizes are awarded every 2 years in a partnership between the Kavli Foundation, the Norwegian Academy of Science and Letters, and the Norwegian Ministry of Education and Research. Each of three international prize awards consists of $1 million and a gold medal received in a ceremony in Oslo, presided over by a member of the Norwegian royal family. The Kavli Prize laureates are selected by the Norwegian Academy of Science and Letters, based on recommendations from prize committees, comprised of leading international scientists from 6 of the world's most renowned science societies and academies. In the 3 scientific fields, astrophysics, nanoscience, and neuroscience. The big, the small, and the complex. The Kavli Prize has four ultimate purposes: to recognize outstanding scientific research, honor highly creative scientists, promote public understanding of and appreciation for scientists and their work, and to foster international cooperation among scientists. Time and time again, we have seen that achieving these goals has been critical to making this world a better place. The Kavli Prize continues to be driven by the same sense of awe and curiosity felt by Fred Kavli as he grew up in the midst of nature at its most sublime, experiencing the vastness of the universe.
Greetings from the Kavli Prize partners. I'm Eric Marshall, Director of Prizes and Special Programs at the Kavli Foundation. Thanks for joining us today and for your resilient dedication throughout this challenging time. The work you do is tremendously important. It's a pleasure to bring you Ewine van Dishoeck, 2018 Kavli Prize Laureate in Astrophysics and Professor of Molecular Astrophysics at Leiden University. She helps us answer some of our deepest and most fundamental questions about our origins in space. I've been so impressed with Ewine's dedication to public engagement. One of the first things she wanted to discuss with me during the 2018 Kavli Prize Week festivities in Oslo. Please enjoy her talk today, ask good questions, watch a virtual tour of Ewine's lab during the nocturne, and look for the opportunity to participate in an Excite workgroup later this year on science engagement in astronomy and space science. It's in collaboration with the ESE Excite Space Group. Thank you very much.
Wow. I'd like to invite now Mariette Hollet, who is a member of the annual conference program committee, a dedicated bunch of people from across Europe who come together every year to help bring you our conference. Mariette.
Hi, Doris. Hey,
Mariette, how are you? And can you please audio describe yourself?
Sure. Thanks, Dorothy. I'm really good. I'm really happy to be here with you and with Brad. And I guess on behalf of the entire conference program committee, we're so excited to bring this wonderful program to the Excite community today. So very exciting day. I guess I should audio describe my name first, because a lot of people struggle with it. I'm Irish. It's an Irish name. And so it's pronounced Murade, like a parade. I have dark brown shoulder-length hair, have a heavy fringe, and I'm wearing a burnt orange shirt, and I have a geometric black necklace, which is it's made from 5,000-year-old bog oak. So that's me.
Very nice. Thank you, Mariette. And I hear rumor that you are co-hosting our first social event tonight, Excite Goes Eurovision. Can you tell us anything about what might happen without revealing too much, please?
Sure. I might have to do another audio description, because at 4:45, we are all taking a very quick break to get our glad rags on. And then we'll come back at 5 p.m. European time for the very first, and hopefully not the very last, Excite Goes Eurovision. I guess we've got to maintain an aura of surprise and secrecy, yeah. But just to say, we have it all. We have the sequins, we have the sparkles, we have the range of music that Excite is known for, that Eurovision is known for. We'll have an interval act, and of course we'll have public voting. So our Excite audience members will be able to choose the musical champion of the night.
Oh, Mariette, I can't wait. Now, I'm very much looking forward to the keynote. For our audience members, please do write any questions for Ewine in the Q&A tab and upvote your favorites. Now, Mariette, I will officially hand over to you to lead us into the session. See you later.
Thanks, Dorothy. So on behalf of Excite and the annual conference program committee, I am delighted to welcome you today to the first keynote speaker for the Excite Online Conference 2021. Ewine van Dishoeck is a professor of molecular astrophysics in Leiden University. In her research, Ewine studies the ice-cold clouds of gas and dust that exist between our stars. And she studies how the molecules that exist in these interstellar clouds, what they are, what's going on, and these clouds being the birthplace of stars and planets, she studies the processes that are happening as these celestial bodies form. She is a pioneer in her field of molecular astrophysics. Not only does she carry out observations using some of the most powerful ground and space-based telescopes, including ALMA and Herschel, but she has also been, she's led the way in developing some of these observatories, the instrumentation, the satellites, and she has recently been awarded an ERC advanced grant to carry out research using the MIRI instrument on the forthcoming James Webb Space Telescope, an instrument that she led the development of beginning almost 20 years ago at this stage. She has been awarded numerous prizes, including, as we've heard, the Kavli Prize for Astrophysics in 2018, which is really the leading prize worldwide for astrophysics, as well as numerous prestigious international roles. Notably, she's the current president of the International Astronomical Union, and she led the IAU 100, the celebrations for the centenary year of the International Astronomical Union in 2019. She's a passionate advocate for public engagement with astronomy. I've been asked to provide the audio description for Ewine, so I'll give it a go. She has light brown hair in a chin-length bob. Like me, she's wearing orange. That was not planned, but it looks nice together, I think. And she has a bright, beaming smile and sparkling blue eyes, which light up even further when she talks about her work and when she shares her passion for uncovering the mysteries of our universe. I am delighted to welcome her here today, and I'm very much looking forward to the opportunity to have a conversation with her later on today. So as Dorothea mentioned, if anyone has a question for Ewine, please put it into the chat box. You can also upvote your favorite questions. And we'll come together again at 4 p.m. European time on this main stage again for our conversation. We'll try to cover all the questions. I'm going to have loads of questions myself. I'm a former astronomer. I'm having quite a fangirl moment here. So, but I will make sure that we bring the questions from our audience to you. So Ewine, definitely more than enough for me. Really happy to welcome you to the stage. Thank you so much for being with us today.
Well, thank you so much, Myrate, and the whole EXCITE team for organizing this. It's really fantastic to be here. My name is indeed Ewine van Dishoeck. I'm sitting here in Leiden, the Netherlands. I'm wearing orange, our national color, so to say. And I'm going to take you on a tour of what Fred Kavli actually fascinated. The big, the gigantic, the universe, but also the small, the molecules, and also the complex. We'll see that it is actually quite complex in order to form, say, new stars and planets and the ingredients for life elsewhere in the universe. So I hope that you're doing well. Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, wherever you are. It is a pleasure to be now here with so many people. I wish I could look you all directly into the eyes on stage rather than through a Zoom camera. But on the other hand, it allows many more of us to be connected. And I think that's one of the gains that we have had in this very difficult period. So what you see here is actually all of us connected and looking back at our planet Earth, the pale blue dots. Keep that picture in mind, the fragility of our own Earth, how it came together and how it may evolve, because that's one of the themes I will come back to at the very end. Many of you are from science musea, and you can see beautiful exhibitions and paintings there. But one nice thing about astronomy is actually you don't have to go to a museum. You can just go outside and go away from the glow of the cities from the lights. Just go to a dark place and you can see the beautiful night sky. And that's available to all of us everywhere in the world. We can even do it very nicely with social distancing. And just when you stare at the beautiful Milky Way, as we see here, after a while, automatically, some of these big questions start to come to you. Where do we actually come from? And what is our place in the universe? And these are questions that not just fascinate scientists. You see that all the way through society. And one of my hobbies is actually astronomy and art, as we will see a little bit later. And so I always go to museum and I try to find somewhere a painting or some object that is related to astronomy. And of course, in the Netherlands, you don't have to go very far for that. You find paintings of Van Gogh with the starry night. You find them everywhere. Here you see beautifully the Big Dipper actually over the River Seine. But also elsewhere in the world. Here, for example, Australia. The Aboriginals have the beautiful starry night actually above them. The Milky Way on the southern sky is so much more beautiful even than on the northern sky. And there, these dreamings, these Milky Way dreamings, have actually become part of their cosmology, about their way of life. What you see here is actually the Milky Way painted. You see the spiral arms there, but you also see here the seven sisters that are actually being hidden in the center of the Milky Way, the dusty part, because an old man, Orion, is actually chasing them. Now, these dusty places in the Milky Way, that is actually where our origin is. We, meaning our solar system, was once born some 4.5 billion years ago in one of these very dusty regions. So let's take a little further look actually at our Milky Way. So suppose we could actually step out of the Milky Way and look at it from above. And then it would look something like this, which you see here. You see here again the spiral arms. And you see the center of our galaxy, where we now know that there is a supermassive black hole there, Nobel Prize of 2020. But there is also, 250 billion other stars in the Milky Way. And our sun, our star, is just one of those few hundred billion stars. And we actually live on this small rocky planet around this ordinary star, somewhere in the outskirts of our galaxy. Just to give you also a little bit idea of scale, the nearest star that we have is a few light years away, Proxima Centauri. This entire galaxy here, the radius is some 50,000 light years. So you see already that, again, we are just a tiny little part. Our sun environment is just a tiny little part of that big galaxy. But all the processes that I will describe actually hold generally within a galaxy and even also in the other hundreds of billions of galaxies that there are in the Milky Way. Now, one of the most exciting discoveries in astronomy over the last 25 years has been undoubtedly the discovery of exoplanets. And how do we discover actually these planets around other stars? Well, simply, as you just saw in this little animation, if a planet goes in front of the star, then it dims the light a tiny little bit, and that results in a dip of the brightness. That happened when Venus passed in front of our sun a number of years ago. And in fact, tomorrow, the moon will pass in front of the sun and will result in a tiny little dip of the intensity. Well, actually, depending on where you are on Earth, it may actually be a somewhat bigger eclipse even. But there are also another way of discovering these planets around other stars, and that is what actually led to the Nobel Prize in 2019 by the Swiss astronomers, Majura and Kalos, where they used the fact that this mother star is actually not standing exactly still. Our sun is also moving a tiny, tiny little bit because the most massive planets in our solar system, Jupiter and Saturn, are pulling on it a little bit. And you can see this motion of the star actually by the Doppler shift. When it comes towards us, a little bit blue shifted, when it goes away from us, a little bit red shifted. So the frequency changes a little bit, and that we can detect with the various instruments. And through these two main techniques, We now actually know that planets around other stars, these exoplanets, are very common. On average, every star has at least one planet. But they are actually of a very wide variety. So here you see an artist's impression of the exoplanet zoo, as we call it. You see planets like Jupiter and planets that might look like Saturn, or planets that might even look like Earth, tiny little planets over there. But it turns out that the bulk of these planets are of a type that we don't have in our own solar system, so-called super Earth or mini Neptunes. So between about 1 and 10 times the mass of our own Earth. And that makes age-old other questions very relevant, namely, what is their composition? Could they be habitable? How are they made? What actually sets this variety of exoplanets that we have? And are we special in some way, our solar system, or not? And directly related to this is this big question, how we reformed actually some 4.5 billion years ago. And we're getting some information of that from the leftovers of the formation process in our solar system. You're all familiar with the asteroids in the asteroid belt. And in fact, there have been just two missions, a Japanese mission, Hayabusa 2, and Osiris-Rex, a US mission, that went to an asteroid, and they actually picked up a little bit of material and are bringing it back to Earth in order to study in laboratory here on Earth. Also, meteorites that fall on Earth on a daily basis actually can be studied in laboratories. And they tell us something about the conditions that were present some 4.5 billion years ago in the inner solar system. If you want to know about the cold outer solar system, we have to go to comets. Comets consist not just of rock, but they actually consist of rock and ice. And the Rosetta mission by the European Space Agency, ESA, actually went for the first time to a comet and landed on it in 2014. A fantastic result. And it actually was able to sniff the gases that came out of this comet. And that again tells us something about the material out of which our solar system was built. So both of these are actually messengers from our early solar system, the inner solar system and the outer solar system. Now, this is usually the moment where I ask the audience, do you recognize this constellation? And then after some murmuring, I hear, ah, yes, Orion. Good. This is Orion that you see here, and especially the lower part of his body with the belt and the sword. You see here lots of stars actually on this image. Now, what we are interested in is not the stars, but the material between the stars. And in fact, few people ask that question, what is actually in between the stars? That space between the stars is not empty, but it's filled with a very, very dilute gas. And it is the denser concentrations of that gas that we actually call clouds. And one of the most famous clouds is here in the sword of Orion that is called the Orion Nebula. And as we will see, that is actually where we'll find that lots of stars and planets are being born. So let's take a further look at these dark clouds. What you see here is an image by the Hubble Space Telescope that was taken of the Carina Nebula. And we see here these dark clouds actually as silhouettes against a bright background nebula. And if I would now point my telescope at one of these dense clouds that you see over here, that is actually where I would detect new stars and planets being born. Now, why are these clouds actually so dark? Well, they are dark because they contain tiny little dust particles. You know, think like, you know, pieces of sand on the beach, but then a factor of 1,000 smaller. And these little grains of sand and these tiny grains of sand, they actually absorb and they scatter the radiation. And that is what makes them look dark. So think of it as when you have smog in our own Earth's atmosphere, then you also know that it is actually very dark that you cannot look very far. That's the same thing what happens over here. So these dark clouds are, dense clouds, are actually the locations where new stars and planets are being born. And as we will see, that's also where we find our molecules. So a little bit of chemistry.
You've all had high school chemistry, and you may remember the periodic system. Well, it looked a little bit different in your high school class. This is the astronomer's version of the periodic table. And hydrogen is by far the most abundant element. It was made already during the Big Bang in large amounts. Also a little bit of helium at the time, about 10% in number. But since the helium is a noble gas, it doesn't do that much chemically. The chemically more interesting elements, like carbon, nitrogen, and oxygen, the elements that we are actually made of, those you see here actually in very small amounts, at the levels of a fraction of a promille, actually, with respect to hydrogen, carbon, nitrogen, oxygen. And if we go to the second row of the periodic table, it is even less. So this was actually the big surprise. These clouds that we saw, they are very tenuous. They are more empty than the best ultra-high vacuum that we have in a laboratory on space, only a few thousand particles per cubic centimeter. They are very cold, only just above the absolute zero. And yet, they have a surprisingly rich chemistry. 50 years ago, the chemists told the astronomers, well, don't even bother looking for molecules, you won't find them because of these conditions. But fortunately, the astronomers didn't listen. They started tuning their receivers, and they found one interesting molecule after another. So this is just an example of some of the molecules that we find. We detect them through spectroscopy. That is both because the molecules can rotate in space, as you see here of this water molecule. They can also vibrate. And that means that we can detect their signals at infrared wavelengths and at millimeter wavelengths. So somewhat longer wavelengths than we can see with our own eyes. And we've detected water, methanol, what's dimethyl ether, acyl cyanide, all kinds of molecules that are actually also familiar, quite familiar on Earth. In fact, this particular molecule that may be familiar to lots of you, again, listening, which one is that? Yes, that's alcohol, ethanol. Actually, quite a lot of it in space. The Orion Nebula that I showed you may contain enough alcohol to fill some 10 to 27 bottles of whiskey. So if by the end of the day you are dry and you're in need of a beer, you can always fly still to an interstellar cloud and tap a nice glass of beer there. But it's not 40%, it's actually less than 1% in space, the alcohol with respect to the water. So we see these molecules, well-known familiar molecules. We also see polycyclic aromatic hydrocarbons. This is much larger molecules that are familiar to you because they're in the exhaust of your car, or when you leave your steak a little bit too long on the barbecue, then you also start making lots of PAHs. And these molecules actually are very sturdy. They are not easily destroyed by UV radiation. Of course, in these dark clouds, the molecules are protected against the UV radiation, and that dissociates the molecules in the more empty space. Simplest amino acid, glycine, has actually not yet been detected. And also this molecule, caffeine, has not yet been seen, a molecule that may not be so important for the origin of life, but it is certainly important for, say, the maintenance of life as we know it here on Earth. But the point is that these molecules that are sort of prebiotic importance, the building blocks actually for life elsewhere in the universe, we are already seeing some of them. We're already seeing some sugars, some peptide, beginnings of peptide bonds. And so it's only a matter of time before we can dig even deeper and maybe detect molecules like the amino acids. We're also trying to understand how they are actually formed. And for that, we use the laboratory. We simulate sort of a tiny little part of interstellar space in the laboratory, as we're doing here in Leiden. Of course, we cannot recreate all the conditions. We cannot wait for 10,000 years for a reaction to proceed. So we have to speed it up a little bit for our PhD students that have 4 years of time. But for the rest, we can simulate actually the cold conditions very well and then also do the extrapolation to somewhat longer timescales. And together from these laboratory experiments and from our observations and from our modeling, we now think that we know how the bulk of the water in the universe was actually formed. And that is on those tiny little dust grains that you see here. Ah, there you saw a hydrogen, the white balls actually arriving, meeting another hydrogen going off as H2. But they can also encounter, they're a red atom that's oxygen, can make molecular oxygen. Now we're making actually hydrogen peroxide. We've seen all these intermediates in our experiments and also in space. And now we're making actually two water molecules. That's in a few days. And now we speed up the process and now we go to some 10,000 years, 100,000 years. And that is when we are actually making a tiny little ice layer actually on this dust grain. So if we go actually back and start this nice movie one more time. So again, this is, of course, an animation, but it's based on real laboratory data, observations, and modeling. And so here again, we have our hydrogen and our oxygen that move over the surfaces of these grains. There arrives once a day a hydrogen atom, finds a partner. You can see sort of the surface of a grain as a meet and greet location. And there now we are starting to make water. And here, there we are making hydrogen peroxide. And now we're making the two water molecules. And now we're starting to speed up to 10,000 years. And that's how we are making most of the water. So think about it. This is, we think, the way that most of the water is formed that we have here in our own solar system and also in our galaxies. So as one of my colleagues says, the water on Earth is actually older than the sun itself. So think about that the next time that you actually take a sip of water. I've just drunk some water molecules that are some 4.5 billion years old. So we can actually see the water with special telescopes. This is data from the Herschel Space Observatory, and that was a telescope that was satellite that was very well suited to observe water above the Earth's atmosphere. And from the strengths here of the signal, we can count the number of water molecules that we have. And in this case, it's actually in a planet-forming disk, and this signal translates to some 6,000 oceans of ice that are actually available to build planets. So saying that at least in several of these disks, there is enough water actually available to build a planetary system like our own. Now, this results have not gone entirely unnoticed. Also, even to the larger audience here of the Big Bang Theory, you see here that actually water and also ionized water are listed here. So to summarize this part of the talk, chemistry between the stars, actually very rich, surprisingly rich, in spite of the cold and tenuous conditions. We see simple molecules like carbon monoxide, carbon dioxide, but also more complex organic molecules and water. And we find actually quite a lot of it around most of the forming stars. And we see it not just in one location, we see it wherever we point our telescopes at young stars, at least the bulk of them. We see that throughout the entire Milky Way. And as I will show at the end, there's actually a large similarity in the composition with comets, suggesting that a lot of this chemistry is already set here in the clouds at a very early stage. So the building blocks for prebiotic material are certainly widespread here in the galaxy. So that was the chemistry. Let's now turn to a little bit more of physics. So here you see again one of these dark clouds, and it will be stable for maybe some 10 million years or so, but ultimately the gravity will take over and the cloud will simply start to collapse under its own weight. And because the cloud always has a tiny bit of rotation, that means that material cannot continue to fall in radially, but it will actually end up in a rotating disk, an accretion disk, around the young star. And that accretion disk is actually the size of what we know in our own solar system. So let's look a little bit here at an animation of this. So this is an animation of such a rotating disk of gas and dust. And you see there a young planet in there, and it basically attracts the gas and dust in its surrounding in its surroundings, and it sort of creates a gap, a cavity in the disk. And that is actually what we as astronomers can see. Seeing that tiny little planet, young planet, is very difficult to see. But we can see sort of the gap and the cavity that we actually make here in this planet. Now, this idea that planets form in these rotating disks is, of course, something that was speculated already about centuries ago. For example, Kant, but also Swedenborg, they already noticed that our planets all orbit in the same direction. They're all more or less in the same plane, and that led to the solar nebula hypothesis. An exciting result of the last decade is actually that we can now see these planet-forming disks, and we see this planet formation in action. In fact, the Atacama Large Millimeter Array has been revolutionary and has been transforming basically this field. What you see here is a disk around a young star. And we had all expected it to be rather smooth, certainly for a young disk like this one. But instead, it has all these rings already in it, these cavities. And we also see that this is the size, more or less, of our own solar system. Here you see, for comparison, where the orbit of Neptune would be. And this is not just one disk. There we now have actually galleries of disks, both from our own work and also from other work. And this is the wonderful work by Andrews et al., where you see here a gallery of some 20 disks that all have these fascinating structures in them. You see here rings, you see cavities, you see spiral structures, you see asymmetric peanuts. All of these are likely indicative of planets that are being formed there at this very moment. So to summarize this part, out of these dense clouds, actually new stars and planets form. Nearly all of these young stars are surrounded by such disks, and they have sizes that are comparable to those of our own solar system. And also masses are enough to form planets. And most excitingly, the fact that the structures in these disks then point to planet formation in action. So also the ingredients for planet formation are common. Now, none of this would have been possible without new technology. And certainly astronomy is driven by technology. Technology is the basis for so much that we have in society and in science. So think of this as, in the year in the 1970s, 1980s, think of your camera that you would have, not on your iPhone that didn't exist yet then, but a normal camera. And think of it if you would have only one pixel. That's what an image would look like. Now, of course, we have a million pixels in our cameras. And also in our astronomical observations, we have many more pixels. And that means that now, rather than such a one pixel image, we now get these beautiful images of these star forming clouds. This is actually a beautiful image from the Herschel Space Observatory. This is at very long wavelengths, far infrared wavelengths, radiation we cannot see with our own eyes. So that is why as astronomers, we have to sort of give a color to each of our filters. A blue filter here in this case, a red filter, longer wavelengths and shorter wavelengths. And that's how we can sort of visualize this type of radiation that normally you cannot see. Now, why did we need actually this new instrumentation for studying planet formation? Well, that's because these disks are small. On the size here of this entire cloud, if it was this big, wouldn't be any problem. But in reality, these disks are tiny on this scale, a factor of 100 to 1,000 smaller. Ah, there you see the little dots disappearing. So that is what we actually needed, the sharpness of ALMA in order to zoom in on these disks. Now, what is ALMA? ALMA means soul in Spanish. It's a part of my soul by now. It's the Atacama Large Millimeter Array. It's the first worldwide collaboration in astronomy. It's a collaboration between Europe, between East Asia and North America. And together they have put this array of some 66 antennas that work at millimeter wavelengths. So think of radio antennas, but then at shorter wavelengths, wavelengths that are operative in your microwaves, that are measured here. And it's the array is actually put here together in northern Chile, that's the boundary here between between Chile, Bolivia, and Argentina. So why did we go there? Well, as the New York Times already said, it's truly high and dry there. We need to get away from the water actually in our own Earth's atmosphere. So you see here the beautiful volcanoes that you have in that region. You see here also a prototype of the transporters, but now we, of course, we have upgraded the transporters a little bit. And this is the modern transporters that we use in order to drive our telescopes, each of them 12 meters in diameter, from the low side here to the high side. In fact, it's an enormous testimony to high-tech technology. Just think of the logistics. You get components from everywhere in the world, from Asia, from Europe, North America. They arrive at a port somewhere in northern Chile, and then they are driven here to this intermediate site at 3,000 meters where your brains can still think. And you can put a telescope then together. You can test it. And then once it's fully tested, it's put on this transporter and it's driven up the mountain to the high side at 5,000 meters, where they are then put into the array. Those are the telescopes. Of course, every telescope also has to have eyes and ears. And these are the receivers that are basically receiving the signals from space, detecting them. Very high sensitive receivers work at the so-called quantum limits. And we are proud that also in the Netherlands, we have provided several of these receivers. So here we see the array as it is now, and I can assure you, I was last there still in September 2019. It's always a breathtaking experience, really, to be there at this beautiful site at 5,000 meters altitude. So ALMA actually works as an interferometer. That means that the 66 telescopes actually work in concert. They together follow an object over the sky. And then a supercomputer actually combines the signals from all of these 66 telescopes in order to generate an image that is much sharper than you would get from a single telescope. So basically, it simulates a telescope that would be more than a kilometer in diameter rather than just 12 meters in diameter. I think this example of ALMA also illustrates another very important aspect of our fields, and that is international collaborations, which are, of course, not just in astronomy, but everywhere in science are becoming more and more important. A beautiful example of that is the European Southern Observatory, ESO, which runs, besides the European part of ALMA, also here these big 8-meter class telescopes here on Cerro Paranal. And then in Europe for space, we have the European Space Agency, ESA, not to be confused with ESO, that launches the satellites in space, like the Herschel satellite that we used for the water. And it's wonderful to see also the interaction with the institutes and scientists in the member states, because they are actually the ones that design and build the instruments that go behind these telescopes. So again, the eyes and the ears of these telescopes are built in the member states. And that's how we get knowledge and access also to these telescopes. Further, very important aspects of these multinational projects is their archives and their open data. This policy that is now more and more in place, started by NASA for their telescopes, like the Hubble Space Telescope, but now also by ESA, ESO, all of these have archives that are accessible anywhere in the world. And if it's the Gaia satellite, there's not even a proprietary period of 1 year. The data are immediately made public of more than a billion objects and stars to everybody in the world. So whether you are in Africa or Southeast Asia, you can do your research at the same time on the same quality data as a researcher in Europe could do. So this is one of the things that we bring to society, the excitement of the science and the technology. We also bring talents, and I feel very fortunate myself to have been the supervisor of so many excellent PhD students and postdocs, master students. You see here a few of them, and it's a big thanks to all of them, because they are the ones that have actually made this exciting research possible. I'm also fortunate to be the president of the International Astronomical Union at the moment. It's the professional organization of all astronomers worldwide. And what we do is we not only stimulate research through conferences, but we also stimulate outreach, education, and development. So for example, outreach, we just had our Communicating Astronomy to the Public conference a few weeks ago, CAP, as we call it, and we had more than 1,000 people participating in that. So sort of the astronomy part of Excite, and that was also very exciting to be there virtually. Development, this is not just development of astronomy, this is really also using astronomy for development, for capacity building in developing countries. And that is a very important aspect as well. So in terms of the 100 years celebrations that was mentioned already, in 2019, we had our centenary and we used the opportunity to have some more than 5,000 activities in more than 140 countries. And we reached some 5 to 10 million people directly there and more than 100 million people indirectly. And we were so lucky that we were able to finish this right before the pandemic hit. So I'm very happy that we were able to have this just before our world turned into a very different world. What you see here is actually our worldwide network. And the reason I'm showing this is not to show the 143 countries that are participating, it's showing the ones that are not yet participating. And this is this gap that we still have here in Africa, especially in West and Middle Africa. And so this is where I would really urge everybody to reach out and help sort of in the development of science there. One of the activities that we had as one of our flagship programs in 2019 was Name ExoWorld. A very simple idea that every country could name one star and one planet, a star that one could see with a small telescope from, say, the backyard of your house. And the IAU has the naming rights to all of these stars and planets. And the idea was to have a competition so that the entire population could actually propose names and also participate as long as they were according to a number of themes that were prescribed. And so the Netherlands actually chose in the end for its stars and planets the Sterrenwacht and the Nachtwacht. And so you recognize this as famous Dutch paintings. In Poland, actually, they had Solaris and Pyrrhus. And I understand that those are actually characters and places in Polish science fiction. Take Italy. There, actually, they had two names that are associated with Greek mythology, the underworld rivers, as they are actually in Dante's Divine Comedy. And then this one in Norway, I also like a lot. These are actually celestial bodies. I think Nasti is the star and Alpni is the sky in the indigenous Northern Sami language. So again, this is a way to bring home to people the message that, hey, we are this tiny little place here in the universe. There are other worlds out there, other worlds that you can actually name and that you can see with a small telescope from your backyard. So this education and training development is an integral part of what we do as astronomers, also through the IAU. Either science-wise, using gravity. In 2019, of course, there was the solar eclipse, but there was also the 100 years of the Eddington solar eclipse, which proved relativity, general relativity. So that was a good occasion to focus more on gravity in teaching. But you can also use the climate on other planets, like here on Venus, to talk about climate change, which is, of course, a very important topic to highlight to the general public. We attract children to the sciences, for example, through our mobile planetaria, where in the Netherlands we have already reached more than 300,000 children, about 15% of the cohort. Wonderful way to get them familiar with the night sky and various astronomical phenomena. And also this image that I'm sure many of you have seen, the first image of the shadow of a supermassive black hole in 2019. I think that went crazy all around the world, viewed by some 4.5 billion people. And again, it allows us to talk about science and what this means. So that is why you, as science communicators, as science museum, are so important for society and for the next generation. As Minister Pandor from South Africa mentioned at the United Nations last year, astronomy inspires curiosity, optimism, and hope. And ultimately, of course, curiosity is a driver for innovation. We can use astronomy in order to inspire these children not to become astronomers, but to become scientists, to be drawn into the sciences, and in that way contribute to society. In my last few minutes, I would like to go back to science and to planet formation. And I'm doing this with this picture, and actually an English engraving from 1798. And it's called the Universal Solar System. It shows not just one solar system, but many more. And this engraving was actually part of an exhibition that we had in late 2019, actually up to the day of the lockdown in 2020, in the wonderful Boerhaven Museum here in Leiden, which was actually the European Museum of the Year in 2019. It's called Cosmos, Art and Science, and it was actually a mix of various of these astronomically inspired paintings, objects, etc., together with actual science. And I think tomorrow you will also see a little bit more about that in some of the movies. But back to this specific engraving, because this artist, already centuries before we knew that there were other planets, he speculated already about these other planets. And he realized that other solar systems don't need to look like our own solar system that you see here in the center, is the seven planets that were known at that time and a few comets. Some of them can have more planets, some of them less, some closer by, some further away. And so this leads to this whole question, actually, how planets form. This planetary diversity is exactly what we are observing today, but how do they form? You can observe the exoplanets, you can observe these tiny little dust grains, but what is in between, these 13 orders of magnitudes that we need to cover to go from this tiny dust grain to something very big, we cannot see them. And that's where we have very little information except from our own solar system constraints, but that's just one object. So this is actually one of the suggestions as what we think is actually happening in these rotating disks. So you have these tiny little dust grains, say micron size, like these little grains of sand on the beach, and they will collide from time to time. And when they collide, they can stick and they can grow. They can grow larger. They can also sometimes bounce and become smaller. But eventually, there we see it. Yes, there are some of them are sticking and becoming larger and larger and growing more and more until we eventually grow to what we call planetesimals. Planetesimals are actually the building blocks of the planets. So in a very schematic way, we've started here with these tiny little grains, and we grow them step by step to these planetesimals, kilometers. This is actually the size of the comets. And this is why these are so important, because these are the building blocks of the planets. This is where gravity between them starts to take over again, and we can start to make bigger objects like, for example, moons, and what you have here, then eventually, or not, something that may look like Earth. So when we are looking at comets, what do we see? That's why we were so excited of the mission to Comet 67P. Some of you may have actually seen comets. There was a beautiful comet, NEOWISE, last summer, one of the first comets since Comet Hale-Bopp that could be seen again with your own naked eyes. Now, what you're looking at actually there at these comets, at these tails, is the leftover material from the building of our own solar system. And what we see there when we sniff the gases, that like Rosetta did, is a very large similarity in the composition between our clouds, our young disks, and these comets, suggesting that this material is largely preserved during the planet formation. So this is just to show you how Rosetta worked. It had, as you can see, a very good nose, actually, for sniffing the material that came out of that through a mass spectrometer. Could these new worlds be habitable? We don't know. Certainly, a requirement is that water can be existing in liquid form, that it is actually in the habitable zone, where it's not too cold and not too warm, where water can be liquid. Here on Earth, that's about perfect. When you go to Venus, it's too warm, and Mars, it's a little bit too cold. And that depends also on the type of star. If you have a smaller star like you have here, then actually the habitable zone moves a little bit closer to the planet star. What the goal is actually for the next decades is not just to detect planets, other planets around other stars, but also to detect and measure their composition. We're looking here not just for water, not just for ozone or CO2, but also for other elements like methane and like some nitrogen oxides that together could actually form a indicator that there could be life on those other planets. What will we find? We don't know yet. But here are certainly some of the intriguing targets that also the upcoming missions are going to look at. For example, this TRAPPIST-1 system, obviously Belgian discoverer, that has seven planets actually around this young star, three of which lie in the habitable zone. So this is why we are really waiting for the new telescopes to come. The James Webb Space Telescope that was mentioned already, that will be launched late 2021, and the extremely large telescope of the ESO that is already in under construction, will be some 39 meters in diameter and plans to have first light somewhere around 2027. And so this is both again, fantastic pieces of technology. And just think of a 39 meter diameter dish. And that's, think how big that is. But these are really wonderful new technologies that will allow us to answer these questions. So let me actually end here with these two very powerful images from Astronomy for Society. You all recognize them. Here, the Apollo 8 Christmas mission that made this famous picture of Earth, the Earthrise. And then this one from Voyager, the pale blue dot, exactly just over 30 years old. Actually, when Carl Sagan asked Voyager 1 to turn back one more time, look back one more time when it was already way in the outer solar system to look back and make a picture of Earth. And that's us, the tiny little dot there. That's home. That are we. So this is all what science gives us. Science and astronomy are incredibly exciting. They provide inspiration, but they also provide perspective, a sense of vulnerability, some modesty, humility, and tolerance. Because when you see this, that we are this little place in the big universe, that makes all of our conflicts look in a very different perspective. So it also drives home the point that we certainly should take well care of our planet. So let me end here again with this beautiful picture of the night sky, the one kind of pictures that also inspired Fred Kavli, and just end and remember this, we are all world citizens under this same beautiful sky. Thank you very much.
Dear Ewine, on behalf of EXCIT and all of the participants, can I thank you for a wonderful and truly inspiring keynote? It was absolutely perfect. Now, Mairead, I understand there is still more to come from Ewine.
That's right. For anybody who's interested, please join us again here on the main stage at 4 p.m. Central European time. I'll be bringing your questions to Ewine, and I'm really looking forward to the conversation with her.
Thanks so much, Mairead, and I will see you later on today. Now, for a quick heads up to everyone that we're about to head into several rounds of sessions. There is a lot happening with topics spanning science and society, biodiversity, exhibitions, learning, smart technology, and there's also one of my favorites, the Turing Exhibition Showcase, that you don't want to miss. You can also use this time to visit the Business Buzz and check in with our wonderful exhibitors. Now, don't worry if you miss a session. We are recording everything and you can always watch a little bit later. Now, before we head off, we have a very short promotional video from our platinum sponsor, Little Rays Nature Centres, which will give you a taste of their upcoming session tomorrow at 3 p.m. Central European time.
Hey guys, I'm Paul Raymond Goulet, or Little Ray, from Little Rays Nature Centre in Ottawa, Canada. Hope everyone's having a wonderful time at the XSight conference. I certainly wish we could be there in person, especially announcing that we have partnered with Museums Partner to tour our exhibits in the European market. Make sure you check out our wonderful virtual tour we're going to have of three of our premier exhibits touring in the United States, getting ready to come to Europe. Have a great day.